Sayın Genel Başkanımız ve Cumhurbaşkanımızı haftalık leader, grup konuşmasını yapmak üzere kürsüye teşriflerini arz ederim.
Is invited to the microphone to make their weekly ordinary speech to the group.
By weekly and ordinary, I mean, it's certainly true that it's weekly. I think perhaps regular would be a better translation for the moment, because this will be anything but ordinary. It is an extraordinary moment for President Erdogan, knowing full well that he has the rapt attention of pretty much the entire world, given the positions of so many major countries. So this is what he has to say.
Honourable friends, members of the Parliament, valued guests, I greet you with heartfelt feelings. I pray the Lord that our meeting brings auspiciousness to our country. I've had a visit to Moldova last week. I met their president, Mr. Dodon, their prime minister also, and the leader of the party that the prime minister belongs to in Moldova. I've had very fruitful discussions with them. And I've had the chance to meet our people in Gökoz, which we consider to be an integral part of our nation. We've had many meetings, gatherings and discussions, and opened many works that we've built in that area. And they are gifts from the Turkish nation to their kins living in Moldova. And a short time ago, I also visited Hungary, and as you know, the Gül Baba shrine or mausoleum was restored, and now it's a different place altogether. Wherever we go in the Balkans or in the region, we are received with the same level of friendship. We always say we are physical.
So as the president does, he's laying out what he has done in the course of the last week and informing his own party members about that. It's a pretty, you can see the size of the support, the majority of the party here in terms of the government, although this is not the main chamber. So this is what you would say is standard fare so far in terms of week in, week out. This is what the president will offer his party members. I suppose, Irem, this is the way it works. We'll get over this and then we can move on to what we really want to hear.
Yes, he just starts by sort of wrapping up what he did in the previous week and what kind of contacts he did, what kind of visits he made, and what's on the agenda. And then he starts talking about the real issue, the messages he wants to give.
How much tension has been created, not just by the event itself, but I think there was a moment at which Reuters had been given access to the consulate before the Turkish police had been given access, and those sorts of elements only add fuel to the fire, I guess, in terms of Mr. Erdogan's view as to how he's going to deal with the Saudis.
Well, from the beginning, the Turkish president, he adopted a very, very cautious and careful approach. Even though we had seen all these leaks coming from the government sources, he started by urging the Saudi officials to open the doors of a consulate to the Turkish investigators, and then he urged them to find out what happened to Mr. Khashoggi. And as I said, he adopted this very careful and cautious approach. We will see today whether he will keep that approach or whether he will go up further, one level up, and directly accuse someone from the Saudi government.
Well, to suggest it's going to be the naked truth suggests it's going to be a powerful statement, doesn't it, one way or the other. Just to point out, if you're joining us now and you're watching as we wait, we will, of course, be straight on to President Erdogan's words the moment he moves into what is the nub of this session. So fear not, we're going to catch every word once he starts to outline his understanding of what has happened over the course of the last few weeks. And as we've said, Paul, I mean, this is the opportunity to address the world and to make the most of a situation which Turkey could actually garner quite a lot of political capital from.
Yes, I think we will learn perhaps more about Erdogan's personal strategy, if you like. Clearly, there's been a process of negotiation which has not yielded fruit as far as he is concerned. He wanted something. We don't know exactly what from the Saudis. Was that cash? Was it a change of Saudi policy in the region? What was it exactly? And also, of course, Mr. Erdogan, perhaps in a parallel negotiation with the Americans. What does he want from them in all of this? But we've reached a point where it seems as though the diplomatic process has foundered, that we are now poised to hear from him some confirmation of all of this sordid drip feed that we've had over the past 2 weeks, some kind of official statement. Yes, this is the Turkish narrative, not just a series of rumours put into the press day by day. This is what we know to have happened. People are very anxious to hear that. We know from what President Trump was saying yesterday, late yesterday, he's not entirely satisfied with the Saudi narrative, having earlier indicated that he was. Britain, France and Germany clearly very unhappy with it. And the British Foreign Secretary, Jeremy Hunt, yesterday in Parliament saying that there are a whole series of questions that still need to be answered. And only when those questions are answered will the British government decide what action to take. Germany has already gone ahead. It's a modest supplier of arms to Saudi Arabia, but Angela Merkel has cancelled arms deals with the Saudis for the time being. So that is the kind of pressure that we're seeing ratcheting up on Saudi Arabia.
And presumably this can certainly add to pressure on Saudi Arabia in terms of what happens to Mohammed bin Salman, potentially, depending on what he says. But here is a guy he's young, he's dynamic, he's also ruthless. We wonder how brutal possibly he also is. And the words that President Erdogan will use will, of course, play very directly into that.
I think President Erdogan has the power today, right now, to possibly to bury Mohammed bin Salman, to destroy his reputation utterly, to say we have the hard proof that this was indeed ordered by the Crown Prince. If he does that, and it's a big if, we don't know if he's going to do that. If he does that, then this mounting sense of the downside, the dark side of the Saudi Crown Prince will become the dominant narrative, not just some sort of background concern that people have, but the dominant narrative. And it could force his king, his father, the king, ailing. We don't know how intellectually sort of strong he is anymore, but it could force him to say, you know what, maybe this is not the right way for the country to go. You know, Saudi Arabia has changed track when it comes to the Crown Prince in the past. Could it do it again? It's be a huge move because in the last couple of years, the Crown Prince has solidified his position very considerably.
Well, the president's on to it now, so let's have a listen.
The fact that he's been murdered at the consulate, Saudi Arabia consulate in Istanbul, has been proven. I'd like to extend my condolences to his family, to the media, members of the media. Before I move on, Let's remember what happened. The first time on the 28th of September, on Friday, he went to the consulate building in Istanbul of the Saudi Arabia. It is clear that a planning activity has taken place. Some people have been informed about his visit. The staff at the consulate left and went to their country in a hurry, which indicates that they've been involved in preparations the day. And then the day before the operation, meaning on Monday, a three-man strong team arrive in Istanbul, check in at the hotel before going to the consulate building. Another team carry out reconnaissance activity in Belgrade forest areas. Another team arrive in Istanbul and check in at a hotel. A third team, a nine-strong third team, including some generals, also arrive at the airport and move into another hotel where they check in. A total of 18 people between 9 and 11 a.m. in the morning, they attend the consulate building where they have a meeting. First, the hard disk is removed at the consulate. At 11:50, Cemal Khashoggi is telephoned and his appointment at the consulate is confirmed. At the same time, Mr. Khashoggi returns from London to Istanbul and he enters the consulate building on foot. His fiancé is with him. After that moment, there has been no news of him from him. At 17:50 hours that evening, reports were received by authorities, Turkish authorities, from his fiancée, indicating that Mr. Khashoggi was being held at the consulate against his wish. An investigation started immediately. Security cameras pointed at the area were checked, and the fact that Mr. Khashoggi had never left the consulate building was determined. Of course, the consulate buildings have diplomatic protection, although it is now a matter of dispute, and the Vienna Agreement is probably going to be revisited. But because of the current belief at the time, or the current practice, the consulate building could not be entered. At the same time, the chief public prosecutor's office in Istanbul appointed prosecutors to investigate this matter. As the investigation deepened, some interesting information was recovered. First of all, on the day before the murder, a number of forensics, intelligence, and other specialist staff arriving in Istanbul was discovered, and also the fact that they had left shortly after the murder, they left the country, was also determined. On the day of the incident, staff at the consulate were getting into a room using the excuse of an audit. They were then released. The Saudi Arabia personnel has made a declaration on the 4th of October and initially totally denied that the allegations that Mr. Khashoggi had been murdered. And they went a step further. They invited the Reuters, a Reuters reporter into the building by, in a non-serious manner, opening and closing cabinet doors and cupboards, etc., showing that nothing suspicious was present in the building. However, our authorities, our prosecutors continued their investigations in their attempt to recover more facts and documents.
Suudi Arabistan'dan ülkemize 11 Ekim'de gelen özel temsilcilerden
on the 11th of October, a special team arrived from Saudi Arabia in our country and made a number of contacts, meet and attended a number of meetings here. Eventually, Saudi Arabia declared that they are planning on allowing the search of the consulate building. My dear friends, of course, we have to ask a number of questions and seek answers to those questions, because this incident has taken place in Istanbul, and we are responsible. If we are responsible here as those occupying the position of responsibility, we have a right to question this matter. As the suspicions disappeared, the veil disappeared, other countries started to raise their voice as well. We've always said that we would not let this to go on without investigation. We waited and made a first telephone contact with Saudi King Salman bin Abdulaziz Al Saud on the 14th of October. During that telephone conversation, I referred to a meeting I had with a team of delegates he had sent prior to that telephone conversation, and we've expressed our wish to join, to form a joint investigation team. On the instructions of the King, teams from our prosecutor's office and the police authorities were able to carry out investigations. Prior to that, the consulate and the consul general would not allow us to have gain access into the building. I did say prior to that a few things about the irresponsibility and inadequate insufficiency of the position of the consul general, the consul general himself being inadequate to fulfill the position he was in, and subsequent to that he was removed from his position. On the 19th of October, meaning 17 days after the murder, the Saudi Arabian administration officially accepted that journalist Jamal Khashoggi had been murdered inside the consulate. In that declaration, it was claimed that Mr. Khashoggi had died in a brawl inside the consulate building. I've had another telephone conversation with the King, Saudi King, subsequent to that. He's explained to me that 18 people considered to be involved in this murder were arrested.
Olaya karıştıkları tespit edilen isimlerle aynı oldukları görüldü.
And we saw that the 18 people who were arrested in Saudi Arabia were the 15 plus three people who had traveled to Istanbul and had gone back to Saudi Arabia. So the names were exactly the same names that our authorities had in our country. On the 21st of October, I had a telephone conversation, a lengthy, comprehensive telephone conversation with Mr. President, President Trump, and we agreed that the matter needed to be brought to light. We've managed this crisis in accordance with our laws and international laws and customs. And there was an intense campaign carried out by numerous media outlets with a view to casting doubt and creating confusion around this issue. We know who were behind those attempts. No one has been able to prevent us from investigating and bringing to open this murder. Before, I should say, it is true that the murder had taken place in a consulate building, but it is important to remember the consulate building in question is within the borders of the Republic of Turkey. In addition, the Vienna Agreement and other international legal provisions do not provide that such a nefarious murder can be protected by claims of diplomatic immunity. Of course, we are going to carry out our duties. And it is important to remember Jamal Khashoggi was a well-known, respected journalist, which brought additional responsibilities on our shoulders. Turkey is investigating this matter, continues its investigation, representing the joint conscience of the humanity. All information and evidence shows that Jamal Khashoggi was killed in a violent, savage murder. This is the details of this incident, this murder is capable of hurting
Suudi Arabistan yönetimi cinayeti kabul ederek aslında önemli bir adım
our hearts, human hearts.
Bundan sonra
Saudi Arabia has taken an important step.
Tüm sorumlularını
what is expected of them from now on is
ve hukuk önünde gereken cezaya çarptırmalarını
bring to light those, bring forward those who are responsible for this, and also towards the fact that this was a planned operation rather than an accidental death. We have strong evidence to that effect. There are a number of questions still troubling people's minds. These 15 people, why did they gather in Istanbul on the day of the murder? We are still seeking an answer to that question. These people arrived there, and on whose orders did they arrive there? We seek answers to that question. Why was it that the consulate building was opened to investigation, not immediately, but many days later? We want answer to that question. Why was it that so many contradictory statements were made about the alleged murder, at the time alleged murder? We want answers to that. And the body of Jamal Khashoggi is still missing. Why is that? We want to know the answer to that question. I'm asking now, if a local operator or a local collaborator has taken the body of Cemal Khashoggi as alleged by an authority of Saudi Arabia, I'm asking the question, who is the local collaborator? This is not just a rumor. An official authority of Saudi Arabia is making this statement saying that a local collaborator disposed of the body. We want to know who the local collaborator is, but I want everyone to know that this matter is not going to go away until all these questions are answered. A number of information is still being evaluated by our investigators, and all information available currently is showing that this was a planned operation. It is not going to satisfy either us or nor the international community that this was just a rogue operation by a few. International community's conscience will be satisfied once all responsible are punished properly. I have no doubt as to the sincerity of the Saudi King Salman bin Abdulaziz Al Saud. It is extremely important that the investigation is carried out of this murder is carried out by an entirely independent delegation or a team of investigators. And others must be included in the said investigation.
İslam hukukununda. İnanıyorum ki
both the international law and Islamic law and the law of the laws of the Saudi Arabia considers that to be a just step. And we are going to ensure that all the requirements of all those, the legal requirements provided by those principles will be fulfilled. We are going to ensure that. I have a call to the Saudi King Salman bin Abdulaziz and the higher administration of Saudi administration. The incident has taken place in Istanbul. The 15 plus 3 people, i.e. the 18 people, must be tried in Istanbul. That this is my proposal. As the crime was committed in Istanbul, they should be tried in Istanbul. But obviously, the decision is there for them to make. But this is a proposal from me, given the fact that the crime was committed in Istanbul. Now, the other matter that we need to discuss today is about amnesty and a vow by children at school, the oath for the children for the children at schools.
Now,
with the MHP party, we have formed.
So President Erdogan is moving on now after delivering a very studied perspective on what happened to Jamal Khashoggi and running through the timeline very carefully, listing the arrivals of various groups from Saudi Arabia as they carried out a reconnaissance before returning for the operation itself, and weaving there a very clear picture, a narrative as to how Mr. Khashoggi was brought in for what he said, what Mr. Erdogan said, was very clearly a planned operation. This was not a rogue operation by a few, he said, as of course the latest Saudi statement has suggested. It was not a terrible mistake, is essentially what he's saying there. And adding, as we heard in his last remarks, that he expects the 18 people who've been arrested in association with this in Saudi Arabia to be tried, and to be tried in Istanbul, which of course is a significant diplomatic statement to make as well as anything else. We're going to chew over some of what was said there. Irin, you've stayed with us through this. Irin Koker from BBC Turkish, and Paul Adams, our foreign affairs correspondent, is here as well. If we can, I mean, we were offered the naked truth. We certainly did get a clear and now, I suppose, an official Turkish timeline on what has happened here.
Well, the timeline President Erdogan provided is pretty much matches what the pro-government newspapers have been reporting since the beginning. So that's sort of an official confirmation. That's one thing to note. Secondly, he specifically emphasized a couple of times that this is a planned, premeditated murder, which suggesting he's not really convinced by the Saudi Arabia's official statement that fist fight went wrong or, you know, negotiations went wrong scenario. Another interesting point was he kind of suggested the Vienna Convention should be reviewed to prevent such incidents, such crimes to take place in diplomatic missions all around the world. And he seems, he talked about the incident, but he stopped short of pointing his finger at anyone at the upper levels of Saudi government.
Do you think that is right, Paul? Certainly not specifically, but he did say, I have no doubt about the sincerity of King Salman, who has said that he will get to the bottom of this and carry out a full investigation. And he did say also, didn't he, I appreciate it, not with giving names, but that all responsible, we will only be satisfied once all those responsible are punished, and I have no doubt King Salman is sincere.
Yeah, you know, he didn't lay out everything he knows. Those who are expecting to hear a lot more today, I think, will be disappointed. I think the reference to having faith in the king was very telling, because he did not say that he had faith in anyone else, notably the Crown Prince. But he did not mention the Crown Prince. He did not point the finger specifically in that direction. In many ways, he said what lots of other people around the world are saying, that there are these unanswered questions. What were these 15 people doing in Istanbul? Where's the body? Who gave the orders? You know, there were a couple of newish details, the reference to the, if you like, the pre, the team that came before the team that we're very familiar with.
The reconnaissance team,
which appears to be even larger than the team that came to commit the crime itself. That they came and conducted reconnaissance activity in the forest that was searched the other day, that included some generals, and that also a member of staff at the consulate departed hurriedly to Saudi Arabia, possibly to discuss the details of this. And so there were some tantalizing details about that. I didn't hear, but I noticed somebody else has picked up that the Turkish authorities removed the security system hard disk from the consulate. So that would be, you know, where some of the CCTV material would have come from. But he is still holding back. He did not say anything about the audio recording. I mean, he alluded to the gruesomeness of the crime, but he did not say, I've heard it, it's awful, it says this, this and this, and by the way, I've shared it with the Americans or anyone else. By the way, the CIA head is currently in Ankara, presumably wanting precisely the same kind of information that we're talking about. So maybe this process of negotiation has yet to run its course.
I think that's the point, isn't it, Irin? He has not effectively blown his lot. He's held on to quite a bit here, which means this will still have a long way to run in terms of the diplomacy between Turkey, between Erdogan and King Salman in particular, perhaps.
It seems that way. And he didn't mention anything regarding how Mr. Khashoggi might have been killed. He just suggested he's not buying the Saudis' claims that something went wrong. So he talked very fondly of King Salman. And he said after they talked, on the phone, the Saudi government accepted this murder took place, that Mr. Khashoggi was killed, and he, a couple of times, he emphasized that this admission is very, very important for him, and he urged him to continue working together.
Can I just ask you this, because you've been following this in the minutest detail, particularly as what is coming in through the Turkish media. There was no reference, as you said, to the audio. We've heard all sorts of stories of pictures, of audio, of accounts of how Mr. Khashoggi died, and the president didn't touch on that. Are you as sure now as you were before he spoke of the validity, if you like, of what we have been told?
Not,
those reports.
Not really. He seems like he's keeping his cards close to his chest. He didn't mention nothing about the audio recording or Skype recording, as it is.
But does that make you now doubt whether they exist? Or
No, not really. As I said, he's keeping his cards close to his chest. He's still this hangs in up in the air, and as you mentioned, it is seems like the negotiations still underway, and this is something that might come up in the coming days or not. We will see.
And as you pick through the diplomatic potential of all this, Paul, he also drew reference to having had a conversation with Donald Trump. And of course, as we've seen in the last few weeks, there are efforts being made between Turkey and the United States to redress their imbalance as well. This would be seen as another opportunity to do some of that.
Yeah, I think in some ways he didn't want to appear to be a kind of reckless leader way out in front of everybody else. He wanted to place himself among the ranks of those international leaders who are asking the responsible questions, giving the Saudis an opportunity to explain themselves. So if he had merely gone out there and done a kind of in-person version of the gruesome detail that we've been getting in his newspapers, that would have seemed a little perhaps unseemly. And so he was dignified and restrained, and clearly this is a process that has not yet run its course.
And perhaps understandably, the moments which drew greatest response and greatest appreciation from his very partisan audience, it is his party after all, were where it was about Turkey and Turkey's rights and Turkey's position in this, and how Turkey's own sense of its own position has been abused. And that came out very forcefully, didn't it? Not least to say, we'll get these guys tried here. Thank you very much.
Yes, I mean, he loves playing the strong man. He loves what an important country Turkey is, how strong it stands, and it doesn't really make much concessions. He's going after this, and he takes this as an issue of humanity. This, he emphasized a couple of times, this is a brutal murder that happened in our country. We are responsible to go deep into it from top to bottom to find who did it. And when he made this call to Saudi king that they should be tried in Istanbul, we heard people were cheering and clapping. So it seems like his party is supporting his call as well.
Certainly behind him for that. Yeah. Well, we've been summarising a lot of what he's had to say over the course of his 30, 40 minutes worth. I just want to pick out a little bit now for you, though, directly from the president's address to his party.
There are a number of questions still troubling people's minds. These 15 people, why did they gather in Istanbul on the day of the murder? We are still seeking an answer to that question. These people arrived there, and on whose orders did they arrive there? We seek answers to that question. Why was it that the consulate building was investigation, not immediately, but many days later? We want answer to that. Why was it that so many contradictory statements were made about the alleged murder, at the time alleged murder? We want answers to that. And the body of Jamal Khashoggi is still missing.
Yeah, and they need answers to that as well. Irin, we were offered the naked truth, and we've had an account, certainly. A whole series of questions there unanswered, and he's correct. Do you think he feels that he probably has the answers, really?
I believe so. A by asking these questions, he's sort of still sending a message that these are the questions we are after, and we can come after you. We still don't know what's happening behind the closed doors, what kind of negotiations are taking place, but we can assume they're still underway. So he mentioned specifically about the location of the body. We still don't know where the body is, and when it is found, we're gonna see whether it is directly being disposed by the Saudi security officers or given to a local collaborator, as they claim. So he's, I think, suggested that these are the questions we're after, and I know the answers to some of these questions. Don't make me talk more about them.
Right, so yeah, so almost a little threat to say, I'll say it if I have to. Paul, just as we were waiting for the president, we were talking about the potential that he had in his hands to influence affairs in Saudi Arabia, notably with Mohammed bin Salman, possibly to move him entirely. He didn't take that. So this is a staging post, really, isn't it, in an ongoing dreadful scenario?
Yes, and I mean, in a way, you know, Mohammed bin Salman was the elephant in the room. He said various things about the king. So in a way, he referred to him by not referring to him. Mm. That is the question that remains. Was that where the orders came from? So if he does know that it was him, if he does know that it was the Crown Prince, he's not saying so, and he's still sort of turning the screws. It's worth pointing out, by the way, that this notion about they should be sent to Istanbul for trial, no one should have any illusions that that's going to happen. Of course, it will not. The Saudi government will want to maintain absolute control over any kind of judicial process that follows from all of this. But that was clearly a line designed to please his audience.
Yes, quite. Well, look, thank you both very much indeed for pulling that apart for us, analysing it and piecing it back together. Irene, Paul, thank you both very much.